Specifically for this case, we've invited our dear colleague, Mr. Frick Brinkhuis. Yes. Can you give us a little introduction, Frick?
Yeah, sure. As Willem already said, I'm one of their colleagues at Time Series, and I've been working with Mendix now for the past 4 years, I think. And before that, I've worked in several roles. One of them was being iOS developer, so I've already always had a bit of a close relationship with mobile development. So the moment that Mendix released their new native platform was a pretty big thing for me, and ever since I can only say that I'm really, really happy and glad to see that it's still being actively developed.
Awesome, yeah. Hey, in the meantime, I'm hearing from chat that chat can't hear you, Paul. Uh-oh, it's like the demo effect.
People are now just hearing Willem talk to someone who they can hear.
This should fix it.
I could do some voiceover for you guys.
That would be perfect.
Hi, I'm Paul! I like Mendix!
Yay! Okay, so what do you say we get started with this video?
Yeah, well... Yeah. What's this video going to be about, you think?
I'm not sure.
Because it's called... Well, yeah.
My expectation would be that it would be something with how to... Or how Mendix Native has evolved in the past year and how you can finally build, like, those real, as they call it, consumer-grade apps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what to think of and what pitfalls maybe to avoid.
Yeah. And maybe some introduction in the new features or the enhancements of the platform.
Yeah.
That would be really cool.
That would be cool.
Okay, so I'm going to start the video. And if you have anything to say in between, I want to pause the video so we don't talk through Denny's recording. So if you have anything to add, please do, and I'll pause the video as soon as I can. So let's get started.
Let's do it. Flashy intro.
Always.
Welcome everyone really at designing consumer-grade mobile apps with Mendix. My name is Danny Roest and I'm product manager frontend at Mendix. And in this session, no slides, just a mobile app. So let's get started.
Cool. Yeah.
Awesome. So first, we will be looking back on last year after we released native mobile. Then I will discuss released features. I will also discuss new and exciting upcoming features. And then we'll also give some best practices and patterns. So let's start. So first, why did we release native mobile? We believe that user experience is very important and users also expect a good user experience. Now, for that, you will need native mobile technology. You do not buy Mendix as a platform for a single app, but more as a strategic choice. So also, our platform needs to be future-proof. And with React Native, we believe we have a future-proof platform because it's a framework that's used by a lot of large companies with a lot of great showcases, and there's a really active and large community around it. And at last, there's also a great technology and architecture fit. So the same component-based approach, the way how data flows through the app and the widgets. And also, we already have React.js for web, and now we also have React Native for native mobile apps.
I think this is really cool.
So if you look at the numbers, and really exciting.
You have like the whole platform now. If you look at all the widgets that have been developed, all the new native features, it's so much more interactive and a lot more capabilities compared to everything that we had with hybrid apps. I mean, it looked cool and it looked like you had a mobile app, but right now you actually have real native apps with real native functionality as well.
Yeah, and even though the hybrid app looked like you had a native app, we do notice the difference.
Yeah, and it didn't really feel like it. I mean, if you compared it to like the real apps in the App Store, then I wouldn't really say that it looked like a real app, especially if you compare it with the current Mendix apps, because in the end, now they're real native components.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, totally agree. I mean, I can remember like a few years ago, we started building some hybrid apps and it would work, but it was always just, with these tiny things that annoyed you, and with a lot of, rework and stuff, you would be able to get somewhere near the feel of a native experience, and then, but still, it wasn't what you'd want, right?
No, it wasn't comparable at all.
Oh, I'm glad they went this route.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So let's continue.
To show these, so these are as of July 1st, and we already have 58 mobile apps in production.
That's nice.
And we almost have 1,000 apps, free apps, also running. And if you look at the installs of the Make It Native app, we almost have...
I like how he's showing his screen on his phone as well. but we can't see.
It's for real, you know?
Yeah.
Exactly, yeah.
It's not edited at all.
It's not a gimmick.
Yeah.
1,500 users that have installed the Make It Native app. And also, there have been a lot of great and interesting use cases and showcases of customers, which I will now discuss. So the first one is VDL Netcar. So they build cars, and they're very have high quality standards. So they want to inspect cars and everything. They want to measure if it's okay or not. And they created an app to quickly scan cars and to see everything that's good in the car, but also if there are still some things that need to be fixed. And also this app allows technicians to quickly inspect cars and also add comments to it if something is not right. So they can quickly start by scanning. So they have a badge to scan and identify the person. They can create remarks on a car and see also the status of the car. So how many things are good or not good or should have some attention. Another nice case is the Hutton Tap and Pay app, which is created by NocoVision, which is an app for company cafeterias. So Hutton is a caterer who works for companies, and they created an app for employees so that they can self-scan their products. So reducing the time in the lines, making employees more happy also with an app they can easily use. They can see the menu of the week, and they can easily scan their own products. So they can do that by using a QR code, but also by using NFC. And they can also pay within the app and see their order history, for example. So this is a really nice case of a consumer native mobile app. Another interesting case is of the municipality of Rotterdam. It's also a combination of multiple partners. So this is created by GemIT, Incentro, and IT Visors. And what they did, they created an app for the civilians in Rotterdam, or the citizens in Rotterdam, that they can easily report things they see in the city. So for example, they have a nice maps. So here you see a maps where they can highlight certain areas where they see something. For example, a broken streetlight. And then they can also choose a category. So what's the issue? It could also be that there's all kinds of garbage on the street. Now, then they can easily take a picture and report it. Another nice example from Schiphol. So the big Dutch airport created by Ordina for floor management. So where employees can easily see the current tasks, what they need to do, but also easily see the situations at the current gates, etc. And they can also use this app to create findings. For example, if they see something that's wrong. So here you also see it. So they have an overview, what's where. Really nice app. Equinix has an app called Time It, and they have a lot of technicians that go on-site at customers, and they are billable. So they need to do certain jobs on-site at customers, and they need to time how long they spend on certain issues and tickets. Now, they created an app for it. It's a bit similar to a stopwatch, but then really sophisticated. So they can use this app to quickly start that they are working on a certain task, and then also stop it. And this makes it much more easier to maintain. Before that, they used paperwork, but now they have a single app that easily registers all the billable hours. Another nice case is Revit. It's called the Clarity app, created by Solvos, and Revit creates sporting clothes. And they do that in a really agile fashion. So they get samples from the factory, and they can easily inspect these samples, make comments, add pictures, add other remarks, and then they can easily collect that and then send that to the manufacturer. And here you see some more examples. And it did also reduce a lot of paperwork or manual Excel sheets. And the last case is an app called Dokter Dichtbij. So it's a service offered by general practitioners for users to see, okay, do I need to go to the doctor or not? Or to easily order medicines or easily create an appointment. So people can do in this app like a self-evaluation. Is it urgent or is it not urgent? Maybe they need to go to the hospital. And this is created by iDevisors. Also a really nice app and very useful, of course, for everyone. And of course, there are many, many other cases, but these are some of the highlights.
I'm wondering what the domain model would look like with the previous one. If you have a head, shoulder, body, feet.
Yeah.
That you all have to synchronize when you are working with the application in offline mode.
Yeah, it seems complex.
Yeah.
My guess is they would have a domain model that mimics the human body. They would have a head, body, and arms.
Yeah, I would do that as well. So what do you think about the other cases? I saw the Hütte case, which is a very cool, there was like a little trailer video a couple of weeks ago, I think. And that's actually a really cool case where you can like pay for your meal with your phone and not even having to stand in line at the cafeteria. That's a really cool solution, in my opinion.
Yeah, definitely. And especially if you consider that it is actually a B2C product. So I think probably Danny will show it after this bit, but the amount of capabilities that you now have with the native app to create proper customer-facing apps, like apps that are having a proper design, that work flawlessly, work quick, enable so much more things you can do with the platform. I think the mentioned case is just a perfect example of how you can build like the perfect B2C app, because I think it looked really cool as well.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, and I honestly didn't expect functionality like this to be supported by Mendix, in a sense that like payments in a Mendix app, my experience with mobile apps isn't that fast. But I feel like that's a big challenge, isn't it? You have to do with a lot of security stuff. You'd have to have some trust in the platform.
I'm not sure if there are actual payments going through the app. Maybe it's just like a little note on your employee card or something, okay, and they deduct it from your salary. I don't know. But
no, but it is actually easier, or not necessarily easier, but the fact that with Nanoflows and JavaScript actions makes it a lot easier. Also, creating a native app, making it register like its own app URL on the phone is made so much easier with both native but also with Nanoflows. That stuff like making payments, like with how you do it when you use Thuisbezorgd in the Netherlands. You are redirected to a page where you do your payment, and then you go back to the application, and all the statuses are updated. And actually with Nanoflows and native, that's been made so much easier compared to working with like the Cordova PhoneGap apps.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, let's see what's up next.
I'm hyped.
And yep. Also what we saw last year is that there is a shift in the type of apps. So there used to do a lot of B2E type of apps, but now we're seeing a trend more and more to B2B and also B2C. And this is all now possible because we're using that native mobile technology for consumer grade mobile apps. And also what we saw is the whole level and the needs and the requirements of app became higher. So also we got a request for more integrations. So for example, and this is also the case at VDL Netcar, they needed an integration with a handheld scanner. So this is an Android device, can do really quick barcode scanning. That's a nice integration. But also, for example, payment integration. So an integration with Payconiq or with PIN terminals.
There you have
and
it.
And at last also, yep, like things like exactly. NFC. This is also used for the Hutton tap and pay concept so that users can quickly scan their food. Okay, this was looking back. So we'll now discuss the release features of last year since we released native mobile. So we already released a lot of widgets with Native Mobile, but also last year we released quite some new features. Yeah, for example, to easily add a background image, also with different position options and opacity, a bottom sheet, nice pattern to show additional options, a carousel, which you already saw in this presentation, but also many other widgets like intro screen functionality to easily add onboarding functionality to your app, or flexible layout grid to make it easy to also position elements onside your pages, list view swiping, pop-up menu, so context menu, star rating, and many, many more types of widgets. So overall, we have a really rich set of widgets to build your apps. And also one of the important features we released last year is the being able to call a microflow. Even though we adopt an offline first approach, you still should be able to call online data or get online data or do something on the servers. Now for
that's
that,
a lifesaver.
We added the option to call a microflow from a nanoflow, as you can see here. And this makes it easy, for example, to fetch data from an external system or from an API. And you can also use it, for example, in a sign-up flow to create an account, or for example, to do complex validations or calculations on the server that might even also require an external service. Also, with Mendix, with native mobile apps, we want them to work even when there's no connection, so you also need to be able to synchronize your data. Now, for that, we have a layered approach to make it very simple to start with, but also having full control when it's needed. Now, what Mendix does by default, it will analyze your model, so your pages and your logic, and based on that, it will determine which data needs to be synchronized to your device. So that's very easy for developers to start with. Basically, your model, your domain model, your pages and your logic, and the data will be automatically synchronized. However, it could be that you want to have more control on which data synchronize or constrain the data. Now for that, we also have the option that you have an overview of all the entities that will be synchronized to your device, and that you can constrain this data using XPath expressions. And for example, you can do this to only synchronize the data of the upcoming week or based on the current location. And if more control is needed, we also release a new feature. It's called the synchronized to device activity, which is a microflow activity. And this microflow activity, you can use, for example, to only synchronize the data you want to synchronize to the data at that point. So from a nanoflow, you can call a microflow. And then in that microflow, you then call the synchronized to device activity, pass only the objects you want to synchronize to the device, and then only these objects will be synchronized to the device. And the existing data is just updated.
How does this work, Freek? Have you...
Yeah, I was just about to ask what you mean with the how does it work, but I assume with the microflows or with the sync to device. So the sync to device, it's really cool. Because usually when you synchronize, you call a synchronize activity in a native application, you synchronize the whole offline database with your online database, and then it will do some smart filtering to see what has to be updated and whatnot. But it would still mean that you have to synchronize a complete database instead of one single object. And although that's still not available in offline mode, you do have the possibility to sync one specific object from a microflow to your offline device, so to your phone. Which actually means that you have much more control over stuff that you retrieve either from a web service, or maybe you have some heavy calculations that you want to move to the server instead of doing that on the device itself. So you do the calculations on your microflows, and whenever you're finished, you synchronize that specific object back to your phone. So I think it's really really powerful.
That makes sense.
Yeah, that requires another way of thinking, right? That you can actually do that.
Yeah, but that's the whole point also with synchronizing. Also to answer the second question, like, are you restricted synced entities now? Yes, you can, and that requires you to think in a completely different way, because previously you just synced everything and you hope that you didn't sync too much, but you're dealing with a completely different kind of both user interface, but also type of application, navigation, structures in the app itself. So it's a different architecture that you need to look at whenever you want to use those offline capabilities and synchronize everything.
Especially the domain model itself will already look different, I assume.
Yeah, Well, that I think that's the good thing about the new sync configuration, although you have to keep your domain model in mind whenever you model a new native app. The sync configuration really allows you to even limit the amount of data that you synchronize more to your device. Like, you're not synchronizing a gigabyte of file documents, but you can sort of restrict that amount by putting some extra specific constraints in your sync configuration, preventing that kind of behavior, which previously, before this more specific sync configuration, wasn't possible. So that would have meant that you would be downloading gigabytes of data if you had 1,000 file documents linked to your account.
It's a nice way to fill up your phone's hard drive.
Yeah, and go through your cellular account.
Nice.
So how does a constraint work, that XPath constraint? Is it like free format and type and you can go as deep as you want? Or is it like a checkbox and Mendix pre-fills the constraints you can select, like in a reference selector?
No, in a certain way, it almost works the same as how you define your security on your domain model. So you can define XPath constraints that can guide a path to the current user or current date time, for instance. But other than that, you also have, and that's from Mendix 8.8 and up, you have the option to select the type of synchronization that you want, because you can sync all the objects, as Mendix call it, and that means that you will synchronize all the objects of that specific entity that by your security rules are available for you. You can also say, I'm not syncing anything. So whenever this object appears in the offline or in the online database, I'm not going to perform a download to my device. So you're restricting the objects that are downloaded. While at the same time, when you create that specific object on your device, it will be uploaded. So that's a very nice way of limiting the amount of downloaded data while you're still able to manipulate that data. And even with that, you have several flavors. You have synchronized nothing, and then whenever you press the sync button, all the newly created data is deleted from your phone, or you preserve the data. So that means that everything that you created offline will stay there and will also be pushed to the online database without downloading the updates. And then the last one is with the XPath constraint, so then you can define extra sort of security or other functional implementations to limit data or create several sync patterns.
Awesome.
Awesome. So
full control, basically.
Yeah, especially as I mentioned, from Mendix 8.8, it's like full control, like everything that you actually could wish for in this specific case, because prior to that, it was just all objects, XPath or nothing. And especially with that nothing and the preserve or delete data, you have like 100% full control actually of the data that's being synchronized.
Awesome.
Yeah. Is it? I was just wondering, but I think I already know the answer. When Danny mentioned that you can use XPath to limit your synchronization, I was wondering, will the data will be stored on your mobile phone's a drive? I think it has like a little database of its own.
Yeah, so you have like your own sandbox database that's only available to your specific app, so not other apps cannot access it, and you cannot access the databases of other apps. But everything is stored in that local database. It's actually the same as with the offline hybrid apps. You have a small SQL, but then a sort of in-memory SQL database that runs within the boundaries of your app, and that's where all the offline data is stored.
Cool. One more thing I was wondering, if we look at the past screen right now, you can see that he retrieves some orders and then syncs them to the device, but can you specify which device to sync to?
No, it's limited. It's like limited, as far as I know, it's limited to the current user. So you have your NanoFlow, you trigger a microflow, and then that microflow is executed in the context of the current user. So it knows what device or what user session it has to sync to. I'm not 100% familiar with all the technical specifics, but my big assumption would be that it would work like that.
Would make sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
And also a feature that will be coming soon is the option to only synchronize a set of objects to the server. And here you also see the synchronized to device activity in how it looks like in Studio Pro.
Yeah, this one would be the best. Like, you don't have to synchronize everything, but you sync one object from your NanoFlow to the online database.
It's like the one missing piece right now.
Exactly, the missing puzzle to complete everything.
Yeah.
Synchronization.
Awesome.
Okay. If you also want to have more information on this, please also check out the offline first session. And last year, we also had a strong focus on pluggability. And pluggability means the extensibility layer that customers and also we can build better and easier widgets. And these widgets are based on standard React Native. And one example I really liked is of the municipality of Rotterdam, where they created a maps widget so that civilians can easily point situation where something is not right, like a broken streetlight or there's garbage in the street. And they have a nice maps. They can click on the location, and then they can create a report for that. And this one is created by Armando Jacobus from GemIT. And also pluggability, if you look at the numbers. So in the beginning of this year, there were still a bit more Dojo widgets, so the old type of widgets. However, if you look at the last quarter, so the second quarter of the year, you already see a strong increase in the pluggable widgets, so the new type of widgets.
Yeah,
and if you look at the total number now, we have even more than 260 widgets. And this was per July 1st. So at the end of this quarter, we expect many more. And this is also
For companies to migrate from Mendix 7 to 8, because in the end, all the new, the cool and the new and the better working stuff in the App Store is not available for Mendix 7.
Yeah. I've run into that many times.
I feel bad for you.
Yeah.
A lot of new features. And so, for example, containment, so that the widget can contain other widgets. Repeatable containment, so you can create a widget that repeats over a certain containment, so you can build things like a carousel or a list of objects. So you can retrieve a data source that has a list of objects, and you can fetch the attributes from that. So for example, to build your own maps widget or create a charts type of widget. And also, of course, we're working on many new features, like conditional visible properties, that you only see the properties inside of a widget that you need to see. So this will improve the developer experience. Also something we're working on is automatic migration of widgets. So if you release a new version of a widget, that your users can easily migrate to this new version. We're working on the preview in studio structure mode,
so
that we'll have a better preview. So as a developer, you can then also define a preview for the structure mode. So no gray boxes anymore. And we're also working on improved dependency management support. So that if you build a native widget, that it can also link to, and that uses React Native modules, that these are automatically included. Now, another feature.
That would be awesome.
Yeah,
currently when you create a native widget, you are still, in some cases, when you use an external library, you still have to do some manual linking, either in Xcode for iOS or in Android Studio for Android apps, to make sure that the native source code for that widget is available whenever you start the app. So that sometimes can be, especially with the older libraries, sort of a hassle, because that linking process isn't always really convenient, and you have to build your application through the native builder even before you can actually test it. So if they can fully automate that process, that would be super cool.
Do we have to see this? How do I put this? Is it the same as with PhoneGap, that you would want to use external library, and then you would have to import that, because that's where all the good stuff is at, that you don't want to develop yourself, but you want to reuse from other people who've created it for you?
Exactly, yeah. And that's also like the real benefit of the fact that they're using React Native now instead of PhoneGap or Cordova. If you look at Cordova, I think there are 8,000, a bit over 8,000 available node packages that you could download, while if you look at React Native, it's over 26,000, if I'm right. So the amount of pluggable actually widgets that you could create with existing libraries is like humongous.
Wow. Isn't it then that when you see all those available libraries that you go like, I want to build this, and I can use this for that?
Yeah, definitely. I wish I had the time.
Anything else about the upcoming features that resonates with you?
Yeah, I'm just curious about the automatic migration. In a certain way, Does it will that mean that whenever I update the widget in the App Store, that everybody that uses that widget automatically gets that new version? Because I could imagine that might be a bit of a, something that you might not really want to have, because that would mean that if you release a bug, which we of course never do, that could mean that you are pushing that to all the people that use that widget as well. So I'm curious to see what that means. But I think the other stuff like the Preview Studio Pro. That would be super cool. I mean, we already have better viewing capabilities in the Studio Pro, but for widgets, it's quite limited yet.
Yeah.
Is it also then so that when you build a native app that you use structure mode more often than the build mode?
I actually just use default as the normal structure mode and don't use the what you see is what you get mode.
View mode, that's, sorry.
Yeah. No, I think the structure mode. I mean, if you've been working with Mendix all that time, you're kind of used to having a view where you only see like the Mendix widgets themselves. That going to a view mode almost feels a bit like cheating, and especially with like the Make It Native app, it's super easy to verify what it looks like in real life instead of a sort of a representation in the modeler itself, which will never be the same as on your mobile phone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was my impression when I looked at the view mode. It just wasn't the way the app looks like in my case, in the browser.
No, I mean, it's maybe 60-70% the same, but like the most important bits of it that you don't see yet.
Yeah.
But who knows, maybe they will come up with that in a later stage. I know that there are some frameworks that actually can do that with React Native. So if they're able to present that as well, then that would be really cool.
That would be Android Studio in Mendix Studio Pro.
Sort of, yeah.
Yeah.
It would be interesting.
So you see with mobile apps is that there's often a notch there, or a camera notch or rounded corners. And you don't want users to render behind it because this looks ugly. However, what we added is a safe area view widget, makes it easy to make sure that certain content, like text, is never behind the notch or never behind the rounded corner. But you can still create full screen images that nicely flow over the status bar. Another thing we also added support for is dark mode and light mode. So light mode you already have by default, but dark mode is getting more and more popular. And this app is now in dark mode, but if I would switch to light mode, and then it will also reload to a nice white look and feel. And we see more and more that it's getting important and people are asking for it. So we also, with Mendix, we offer out-of-the-box support for this.
Now just for the Mendix Studio Pro, maybe.
Please.
Don't get me started.
That is the most requested feature, not all the other things that you mentioned.
Yeah, we shouldn't forget this is about mobile, of course. But.
What we also see with native mobile apps is that people want to have more control. So for example, to refresh a certain entity or refresh only an object. So not only relying on the default commit behavior, but having more fine-tuned control on when to refresh what. Or for example, to show progress in an app if users need to wait for something. But also various other options, like SVG support, which you can now also use for icons, client-side constants. Next to server-side constants, you can also use client-side constants, for example, for API keys or to do environment-specific features. A nice and often requested feature is called clickable containers, so that also you can make containers clickable. Deep linking, so that you can open your mobile app from another app or use it in authentication scenarios, for example. And of course, also notification support, whether it's either remote or local notifications, you can also easily add them. And also one of the important things with mobile apps is how people navigate through your app. And for example, if a user completed a payment wizard or a sign-up flow, you don't want them to go back. So you want to have more control on the history. Now for that, we also added new features. So the option to close pages before opening a page, but also to close multiple pages at once. And that's, for example, what I will also do now, so that I can directly go back to the home screen. Okay.
That is also really cool.
Now discuss.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, I think with one of the first native apps that we built, we already had like those super annoying nano flows that the 7 close page actions had the most ugly animation because it will show all different kinds of stuff. And then when you had one close page too many, then you ended up with a widescreen. So this is really good.
It is really good.
But this is just for mobile, right? Because this would be useful in Studio Pro as well.
I can imagine. Yeah, definitely. Maybe they will come up with it as well. I know it's like that's the fun part. If you look at Mendix Native, it's built on top of React Native, and most of the things they are actually just building or available functions within React Native as well. So it's really cool to see that they adapt those features in the Mendix platform directly.
Yeah.
Some of the exciting new and upcoming features. So the first one I'm really proud on is low-code app publishing. So this makes it easy to build your app and get ready for App Store distribution. And you can use this tooling, and it's just a visual UI, which I will show you in a bit, on how to build an app. And you don't need any complex tooling for that to just do it. However, we also do support for local building or for full pipeline integration. So we support the simple case, but also the more advanced enterprise cases. And what's also nice about this, it's a self-updating tool. So if Apple or Google change the requirements for publishing to the App Store, this tool will automatically update. So you do not have to upgrade Studio. No, you will always be up to date. And I will now show you a short video of this. So what you see here is a screen which you can open from Studio Pro, and you can build an app for distribution or development. And here you can set all kinds of details of the app, and here you can also provide the tokens. So we use a standard service, so Microsoft App Center, to build your app so that you don't need any local tooling. So we'll now provide the tokens. These are also automatically validated, and you can also choose to build locally if you want to. Also support for adding your own icons, so you can upload icons and it will automatically generate icons in all the right sizes. Now, the same for splash screens, so you can upload a splash screen and then it will also generate it. So now it will prepare your whole project, so setting up everything. Now we can start building for distribution, so you can set up your version number, build number, your URL, whether you want to build for Android and iOS or whether you want to build both. You can manage your certificates, so you can easily configure that all here. So really making this whole app building much more simpler.
Yeah, you should imagine that like previously you had to insert one single command in your command line that had like 10 parameters. And especially with the first version, if those parameters weren't in the correct order, it just wouldn't build.
I remember that.
Yep.
Yeah, the fact that they went from that way of building to here is like the biggest leap ever.
Nice.
But it's really good.
This is one of the things to be most excited about, I think. This saves so much time.
Yeah, but it also makes it so much more available to other developers. Mm-hmm. You don't have to explain to someone how to use the command line anymore and that your parameters have to be in a specific order. And it also makes it so much more visual and understandable for people what it actually means instead of, you have an API token, you insert it in this parameter, good luck.
Yeah, hope you didn't put an extra space or something in there because then...
Yeah, that could cost you quite some hours.
And now we can start building. The building takes a while, so I will fast forward a bit in this video.
Takes a while, skips 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
So we do everything automatically for you.
Yeah, that's the only downside. Still. I mean, I like that they chose to come up with a third party to actually bundle the application, so you don't need Xcode or Android Studio. But App Center sometimes is just so terribly slow, and the fact that you only get like 2 hours of build time with the free tier I think it's a waste, but it's perfect that they added the option, like you can enable or disable it. So whenever you run out of build minutes, you can just say build locally and then do it with Android Studio.
Yeah, that's smart.
Yeah.
And we got a question, is this backwards compatible?
So backwards compatible in the sense that you can use this with different Mendix versions, or?
I think so. In a sense, if this were to be released today, and you built a native app in, 8.5.
Ah, yeah, in that way. Can you use this tooling for previously built apps? Yeah, so if you have a native app developed already, then I can assume that this will be released with a Mendix version. But as Danny mentioned, it will be a standalone application. So you don't actually, they don't package it with Mendix Studio Pro itself for the whole reason that whenever Apple once again changes their guidelines and disables all the apps that we build in the App Store, they can make an upgrade to only the native builder instead of the Mendix Studio. So I assume that whenever they release this, and I think it's Mendix 8.14 maybe, or I don't actually know that specific yet. It means that you have to upgrade to that version to actually use the native builder, or if they really release it as a complete standalone app, you can just select the project folder maybe, and then I can imagine since it's just React Native under the hood that you can bundle the app anyway. So hopefully it is backwards compatible, and otherwise you have to upgrade to a new Mendix version.
It's basically a UI on top of the command line command. So
it's just maybe a shell around that command line thing. Yeah.
So hopefully that'll make it possible to be backwards compatible, but we'll have to see.
Yeah.
A bit running, so let's forward another bit. And at the end, when the build is done, it will automatically download the binaries that are produced, and then you can use a QR code scanner to quickly install this on your device. So again, also making is simple. Now, you can also still see builds that already have been built, and you can also build for local development. So for example, if you have third-party modules you have integrated in your app, you can also build your own version of the Make It Native app. So all in all, really happy with this tooling that makes app building much more simpler and really low code. Okay, then another really exciting new feature is called Nanoflow debugging.
Nice.
Oh, and what you can do there is similar to Microflow debugging. And when I click on this page, this button, the show agent date, it will also start debugging. So here you see Studio Pro, and also here there's a breakpoint. So it will now check whether the date was entered, and they can also step into it, but also inspect the variables. So you can really inspect, okay, what's going on, similar to Microflow debugging. Now I can step
this
into
is
all the
save
actions.
So much time.
This is awesome.
You no longer have to add like 20 or 30 log messages per Nanoflow and keep on pressing run locally and test it with a Make a Native app to understand why something is broken.
Yeah, this is exactly what we needed, right? Like we're used to Microflows, now in Nanoflows as well.
Yeah, I mean, this is even with stuff like React Native itself, this is so much better.
But what would you connect to?
You actually connect, I assume with the Make It Native app, you always have the React Native debugger, which is a standalone tool that you can install, I think, as a Chrome extension. And then you can debug the JavaScript code. So I assume that they sort of hooked into that since that's exposed from the Mendix to Make It Native app. So they can just follow or translate like the lines of JavaScript code that are executed all the way to the Nanoflows that you are using at that moment.
That would make sense. Well, nonetheless, a feature to be very excited about this.
Yep. Yeah, this is, I think, the best enhancements for the studio so far.
Even step into sub Nanoflows. That's also really nice. I can also step into Microflows. So even make the switch from client side logic to server side logic and back. And at the end, you can still step through it and easily debug your app. So this is a great feature that will really help in developing mobile apps. Okay. And then also, last but not least, we'll be releasing a whole new theme for mobile and web, and these also will be aligned. And this is all done on extensive research, on common patterns, on best practices, so that we also make it easy for you to easily build great looking apps, also with a great UX. And this contains a whole new theme, but also new content like page templates, building blocks, and widgets. And here you already see a glimpse of it. And personally, I think it looks really good, right? And as last but not least, we also support here dark mode and light mode. And then the last section, I will give some best practices and patterns. Now, what's important to realize when building a mobile app, the user experience is important. And for that, there are different roles involved. For example, you have the Mendix, you have Mendix development, you have front-end development, who does, for example, the styling, the CSS or JavaScript in this case. You have UX design, so who's responsible for the overall user experience of the app. UI design, who designs the screens, how they will look. And it could also be that you also have a widget development in-house, for example, to build additional widgets. Now, it's important to realize that these are different roles, but it doesn't mean they're necessarily different people. So for example, what we often see is that companies work together with a design agency who have a person who does the UX design and the UI design. But for example, in our expert services, we also have people who can do UX design, UI design, but also do front-end design. So it really depends on your case, because it can also be that you have a more technical developer who can also do everything in Mendix, but also can implement the styling, but for example, doesn't have the feeling to make it look really good. And that's important to understand. So you have these different roles, and also depending on the need of the project. So in some cases, it could be that with the Mendix default styling and the default theme, because you can already build great looking apps there, that you can just have enough with just a Mendix developer who discusses with the product owner on how to implement the look and feel. But it really depends on the type of project. So there are also some best practices on the process. So what we advise is to create a UI kit. And you can create a UI kit in Sketch or Figma. And this is often done by the UI designer. And with a UI kit, you can define the standard components and the variations on top of that. And because this makes it easy to later transform this also into a standard Mendix theme. Because Mendix is also about reusing the same components, because this will make development easier and faster and more scalable. So once you transformed
still waiting for this to be translated into Mendix itself. That would be really cool.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing.
They immediately translate it to your components and your styling directly.
Oh yeah. So you would have you could load like one of those Sketch UI kits into Mendix and then have some Atlas UI building blocks that represent.
For instance, yeah, or I mean, you have like the what it was called previously, the app or the theme builder, I think. For the previous Atlas UI, that you were able to modify everything. So if they can even make that more detailed and then use that for native as well, then, well, I guess you're there.
Yeah, because that's a whole different cookie, isn't it? Styling a native app.
Yeah, it depends. I mean, the idea behind it is still the same, but you're just working with a different language. But the structure, if you look at it from a distance, it still looks the same. But you are way more limited in the flexibility, which is a good thing though, because that's, I think, the whole reason why hybrid apps didn't look that good compared to native apps, because you could do everything with it, which sometimes resulted in super ugly interfaces. As well, with the more limited but also restricted React Native way of styling, it feels so much more like an actual native app.
Okay, yeah, I can get behind that.
A theme, you can give this to a Mendix developer. So the Mendix developer doesn't need to have strong UI or UX skills, because he can just use the standard templates and variations available. And he can then use this to implement the design. So it's also really about enablement. So enable Mendix developers to create this great looking feel. And so that UX designers or UI designers can really put their knowledge in the product and enable other developers to implement it. So that scales much better than you would need a designer for every story. And of course, at some point, you also need some project or use case specific styling, which you can then also add. Now, here it's always good to think, is this reusable? Is this a one-time only thing? Or yeah, can I reuse this? And always try to reuse as much as possible, because this will help you later on and make development much more faster. And at last, keep iterating and discussing. As styling, you can always keep improving, you get new ideas, you can make things more reusable, So keep having these discussions with the designers within the team to continuously improve on the user experience. And some last more tips. So overall, it's good to understand that the user experience of mobile apps is very important, and it's also a bit different than with web apps. So for example, the navigation flow. How does a user navigate through your app? Think about it and make it easy for the user that he knows where he is. And a tip, for example, is that once you open a page from the home screen, that you hide the bottom bar so that the user can really focus on what he's doing. But also mobile devices have smaller screens. So in that sense, it's also important to keep that in mind, for example, when the keyboard is open, because that could easily take half of the screen. Also think of dark mode. Often users want to have a dark mode theme. With Mendix, we support it out of the box. But also if you create your own theme, keep that in mind when designing your app, that it also works with dark mode. And provide good defaults. So if a user uses your app, people don't like typing on their mobile phone. So provide as much as good defaults so that users can easily do their tasks. Also, really think about which functionality should be online available or should be offline available, so that the users can always do their task or the task they will need to do, regardless whether there's a connection. And as mobile apps are often really task-oriented and task-focused, really focus also on the task, the things that are important for the user, so that he can really do the things he needs to do with that app, and don't create too much distractions on it. And last but not least, when you need to start publishing your app to the App Store, start early with that, because it's a process that can take some time. It's always good to start early with that.
Definitely.
Okay, that concludes it for this session. So please let us know if you have any feedback. But besides that, I would say, go make it native.
Nice. Awesome.
Good call to action.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Go make it native.
Yeah.
Okay, so final thoughts on this video?
Yeah, I think it's the same as with the keynote opening. The amount of things that they presented, like the recap on what has been delivered in one single year, is just insane. If you saw the first version of the native app, it was cool, but it was still a bit limited and a bit difficult to understand for people. And now 1 year later, it's like, I think one of the best ways to build your mobile app, especially with Mendix, but also compared to other platforms. So it's super impressive what they did in just one single year.
Yeah, what was it called that you could also use for building mobile apps before? That was also kind of low code ish.
I know that you have Appian, I think.
Yeah,
that's a bit the same as with PhoneGap. It's not necessarily low code, but it's cross platform. So you have one programming language for two code bases in a certain way.
Yeah, they basically combined it now with Mendix into one whole big package.
Yeah, I mean, React Native in the end also means one code base, two apps. But then if you use libraries, you sometimes still have to do some specific stuff for iOS or Android. But I mean, the one of the upcoming things, like being able to automatically link your libraries with Mendix Native, if that's covered, then it would be perfect.
Awesome. Can't wait for what they'll release. According to this video, it's a lot.
Yeah, I'm really curious to see, I mean, if what they did last year, if they can outdo themselves again this year, then I'm really curious what we're looking at Mendix World 2021.
Yeah.
This is kind of making me excited to also start building native mobile apps, because I have to feel that the need for, we said it before, the need for the coding knowledge, etc., is less and less important. Obviously, if you want to have specific widgets, then you need that knowledge.
But building that's not different for normal web apps as well, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, still, if you need a widget for that, you might need widget knowledge. But I think especially the studio part is sort of up to par with the responsive way of developing apps.
Yeah.
So Willem, what you're waiting for? Go build native app.
Go make it native.
Go make it native.
All right, then I'm off. I'm going to make a native app.
Laters.
Yeah.
Okay, so do you want to take a quick little break, or do you want to carry on and get on with the next video.
I could just like a 2-minute break.
Yeah, sure.
Sure.
And then we'll be back. And what we're going to look at next?
It was the getting started, I think. So we're creating apps with React Native.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome.
Cool.
So can't wait.
Bear with us with a couple of minutes and we'll be back real soon for the second video.
Yep, stick around.
Elevator music, Paul?
Yeah, I can whip something up, I think.
Yeah?
Perfect.
Sing a song.
not sure if they'll entertain our viewers.
Well, maybe they'll just
the viewers will drop.
Yeah. I'll see you in 2 minutes.
Okay. Cool.